Welcome to Singularities, a panel which actually is put together and moderated by Morehshin, Allahyari and Daniel Rourke in their framework of participating at this year's transmediale with their ongoing 3D additivism project, which you can see in the exhibition Alien Matter here and also at the Shearing Stiftung. So I'd like you to introduce you to them. Morehshin is a new media artist, activist, educator, and occasional curator. She's currently in research at IBEAM in New York City, where she's developing a new body of work on digital colonialism and refiguring as a feminist and decolonialist practice using 3D scanners, 3D printers as her kind of main tools of investigation. Allahyari devises a narrative through practices of magic and poetic speculative storytelling, reappropriation of traditional mythologies, collaging, meshing, scanning, and archiving. And she was born and raised in Iran and moved to the United States in 2007. And this is, of course, a biographical note that has caused her some distress around her possible return here from Berlin. So I think her endurance during this kind of stressful time and appearance here today, it requires actually an extra applause because it's extraordinary, I think. So. Then Daniel Rourke is a writer and artist. In his work, he deals with speculative and science fiction in sort of a radical outside to the humanities, including extensive research on the intersection between digital materiality, the arts, and post-humanism. He's currently pursuing or finalizing his PhD at Goldsmiths University of London. So together, Morehshin and Daniel in 2015 published their 3D Additivist Manifesto, which was a kind of a call for a radical additivist approach to, well, the technology of 3D printing, well, which is an additivist technology, but they were kind of calling for kind of radicalizing this beyond perhaps the more instrumentalization of that through maker culture and calling for a kind of alternative futurism to emerge through additivist practices. And it's been an enormous pleasure to work with Daniel and Morehshin over the past year. They were artists in residence in our Willem Flusser and Transmediale residency program for artistic research. That is a cooperation with the Willem Flusser Archive at the University of Arts here in Berlin. And that led to, they formulated this project of the 3D Additivist Cookbook, which was also launched here yesterday at the festival. That project then, to tell how the story went further, acquired also kind of extra support from the Shearing Stiftung. So that's why there's also an extended exhibition of work from the cookbook that you can still see until the 26th of March, actually, at their space at Unter den Linden, as well as the small selections also here at the Alien Matter exhibition. I'd also like to mention that on the 8th, we have yet another event which will feature Morehshin. It's one of our post-festival so-called excursions. It goes under the title of Imaginaries and happens at the Langenbeck-Wirschoff-Haus. And there will be a presentation there on alternative and Middle East futurisms, of which Morehshin will be part. Also, Rasheedah Phillips, who sits with us on the panel here today, will be part of that day, together with Moore Mother, forming the Black Quantum Futurist Collective, and they will be premiering a new piece there. So please don't miss that, and don't forget that actually this event is not included in your festival passes, so you should get tickets. They're not specifically expensive, but all these post-festival weekend events are, so to speak, extra to the festival that we're having now. So please give them a warm welcome. I'm very happy that they're here and the other guests as well.
Thanks, Christopher and Transmediale for working with us. It's been an honor working with all of you in the last 1 year. Okay. In 1979, the Iranian Islamic Revolution resulted in the overthrowing of the Pahlavi dynasty and led to the establishment of an Islamic Republic. Many different organizations, parties, and guerrilla groups were involved in the Iranian Revolution. Some groups were created after the fall of Pahlavi and still survive in Iran. Others helped overthrow the Shah, but no longer exist. Much of Iranian society was hopeful about the coming revolution. Secular and leftist politicians participated in the movement to gain power in the aftermath, believing that Khomeini would support their voice and allow multiple positions and parties to be active and involved in the shaping of post-revolution Iran. Like my mother, a Marxist at a time, would always say, the Iranian revolution brought sudden change, death, violence in unforeseen ways. It was a point, a very fast point of collapse and rise. The revolution spun out of control, and the country was taken over by Islamists so fast that people weren't able to react to it, to slow it, or even to understand it. The future was now in the hands of a single party with a single vision that would change the lives of generations of Iranians, including myself, in the years that followed. We were forced and expected to live in one singular reality, a mono-authoritarian singularity. In physics, a singularity is a point in space and time of such incredible density that the very nature of reality is brought into question. Associated with elusive black holes and the alien particles that bubble out of quantum foam at their event horizon, the term singularity has also been co-opted by cultural theorists and techno-utopianists to describe moments of profound social, political, ontological, or material transformation. The coming into being of new worlds that redefine their own origins. For mathematicians and physicists, singularities are often considered as bad behavior in the numbers and calculations. Infinite points may signal weird behaviors existing in the physical world, things outside or beyond our ability to comprehend. Or perhaps, more interestingly, a singularity may expose the need for an entirely new physics. Some anomalies can only be made sense of by drafting a radically new model of the physical world to include them. For this panel, we consider bad behaviors in social, technological, and ontological singularities, moments of profound change triggered by a combination of technological shifts, cultural mutations, or unforeseen political dramas and events. Like the physicists who comprehend singularities in the physical world, we do not know whether the singularities our panelists highlight today tell us something profound about the world itself or force us to question the model we have of the world or worlds.
As well as technological or social political singularities, this panel will question the ever narcissistic singularities of I, here, and now, confounding the principles of human universality upon which these suppositions are based. We propose singularities as eccentric and elusive figures in need of collective attention. It's no coincidence that singularity is often used as a term to indicate human finitude, self-same subjects existing at particular points in time, embedded within particular contexts, told through a singular history or single potential future. The metaphor of the transformative singularity signals not one reality to come, nor even two realities, one moved from and one towards, but of many, all dependent on who the subject of the singularity is and how much autonomy they are ascribed. The technological singularity is a myth of the transhumanists, a group of mainly Western, commonly white male enthusiasts who ascribe to the collective belief that technology will help them to become more than human, possessed of drastically augmented intellects, memories, and physical powers. As technological change accelerates, according to prominent transhumanist Ray Kurzweil, so it pulls us upwards in its wake. Kurzweil argues that as the curve of change reaches an infinite gradient, reality itself will be brought into question. Like a black hole in space-time, subjects traveling towards this spike will find it impossible to turn around, to escape its pull. A transformed post-human reality awaits us on the other side, the technological singularity, a reality Kurzweil and his ilk believe we will inevitably pass into in the coming decades. In a 2007 paper entitled Drop in Science Fiction, Darrell A. Smith explores the metaphor of the singularity through Afrofuturist science fiction. He notes that the metaphor of runaway change positions those subject to it in the place of Sisyphus, the figure of Greek myth, condemned to push a stone up a hill forever. For Sisyphus to progress, he has to fight gravity as it conspires with the stone to pull him back to the bottom of the slope. The singularity in much science fiction of black or Afrofuturist origin Afrofuturist authors, focuses on this potential fall rather than the ascent. And this is a quote from Darrell A. Smith. Here, in the geometrics of space-time, the spike lies not at the highest point on an infinite curve, but at the lowest. Far from being the shift into a post-humanity, the negative spike is understood as an infinite collapsing, and thus a negation of reality. Escape from such a region thus requires an opposing infinite movement. That's the end of the quote. This image of a collective push of the stone of progress up the slope necessarily posits a universal human subject, resisting the pull of gravity back down the slope. A universal human subject who apparently will pass victorious to the other side of the event horizon. But as history has shown us, technological, social, and political singularities, arriving with little warning, often split the world into those inside and outside their event horizons. Singularities like the 1979 Iranian Revolution left many more on the outside of the negative spike than the inside. Singularities such as the Industrial Revolution, which is retrospectively told in the West as a tale of imperial and technological triumph, rather than as a story of those who were violently abducted from their homelands and made to toil and die in fields of cotton and sugarcane. The acceleration toward and away from that singularity brought about a negative spike so dense that many millions of people alive today still find their identities subject to its social and ontological mass. In their recent definition of the Anthropocene, the International Commission on Stratigraphy named the golden spike after World War II as the official signal of this human-centric geological epoch, a series of converging events marked in the geological record around the same time. The detonation of the first nuclear warhead, the proliferation of synthetic plastic from crude oil constituents, and the introduction of large-scale industrialized farming practices, noted by the appearance of trillions of discarded chicken bones in the geological record. Will the early 21st century be remembered for the 9/11 terrorist event, the introduction of the iPhone and Twitter, or for the presidency of Donald J. Trump? Or will each of these extraordinary events be considered as part of a single larger shift in global power and techno-mediated autonomy? If we are to rebuild ourselves through stronger unities and collective actions in the wake of recent political upheavals, will we also forego the need to recognize the different subjectivities and distinct realities that bubble out of each singularity's wake? As the iPhone event sent shockwaves through the socio-technical cultures of the West, so the rare minerals required to power those iPhones were pushed skywards in value, forcing more bodies into pits in the ground to mine them. As we gather at Transmediale to consider AI, infrastructural, data, robotic or cyborgian revolutions, what truly remains elusive is a definition of the human that does justice to the complex array of subjectivities destined to be impacted and even crafted anew by each of these advances. In his recent text on the 2011 Fukushima Daiichi nuclear disaster, Jean-Luc Nancy proposes instilling the condition of an ever-renewed present into the urgent design and creation of new mobile futures. In this proposition, Nancy recognizes that each singularity is equal to all others in its finitude, an equivalence he defines as the essence of community. To contend with the idea of singularities, plural, of ruptures as such, we must share together that which forever remains unimaginable alone.
This appeal to a plurality of singularities is easily mistaken for the kinds of large-scale collective action we have seen in recent years around the world. From the Arab Springs and Occupy movement through to the recent Women's March, which took place not 24 hours after the inauguration of Donald Trump, these events in particular spoke of a universal drive, a collective of peoples united against a single cause. Much has been written about the human microphone technique, utilized by Occupy protesters to amplify the voice of a speaker when megaphones and loudspeakers were banned or unavailable. We wonder whether, rather than speak as a single voice, we should seek to emphasize the different singularities enabled by different voices, different minds, distinct votes and protestations. We wonder whether black and brown protesters gathered in similar numbers with similar appeals to their collective unity and identity would have been portrayed very differently by the media. Whether the radical white women and population that united for the march would also show up to the next Black Lives Matter or Muslim ban protests. These are not just some academic questions, but an actual personal concern. What is collectivism, and for who does the collective function? When we talk about futures and worlds and singularities, whose realities are we talking about? Who is going to go to Mars with Elon Musk, and who will be left? As we put this panel together in the last weeks, our manifesto's apocalyptic vision of a world accelerated to breaking point by technological progress began to seem strangely comforting compared to the delirious political landscape we saw emerging before us. Whether you believe political malaise, media delirium, or the inevitable implosion of the neoliberal project is to blame for the rise of figures like Farage, Trump, or in the Philippines, the outspoken President Rodrigo Duterte, the promises these figures make of an absolute shift in the conditions of power appear grand precisely because they choose to demonize the discrete differences of minority groups, or attempt to overturn truth that might fragment and disturb their all-encompassing narratives.
The appeal to inclusivity in virtue of a shared political identity often instates those of normal body, race, sex, or genome as exclusive harbingers of the change which should, or so we are told, will come, a process that theorist Rosie Braidotti refers to as a dialectics of otherness, which subtly disguises difference in celebration of a collective voice of will or governance.
Last week on January 27, as a part of a plan to keep out Islamic terrorists outside of the United States, Trump signed an order that suspended entry for citizens of 7 countries for 90 days. This includes Iran, the country I am a citizen of. I've lived in the U.S. for 9 years and hold a green card which was included in Trump's ban and now is being reviewed case by case for each person who enters the U.S. When the news came out, I was already in Berlin for Transmediale and wasn't sure whether I had a home to go back to. Although the chaos of Trump's announcement has now settled and my own status as a resident of America appears a bit more clear for now, the ripples of emotion and uncertainty from last week have colored my experience at this festival. As I have sat through panels and talks in the last 3 days, and as I stand here introducing this panel about elusive events, potential futures, and the in-betweenness of all profound technological singularities, the realities that feel most significant to me are yet to take place in the lives of so many Middle Easterns and Muslims affected by Trump's ban. How does one imagine, reimagine, figure, refigure the future when there are still so many presents existing in conflict? I grew up in Iran for 23 years, where science fiction didn't really exist as a genre in popular culture. I always think we were discouraged to imagine the future other than how it was imagined for us. Science fiction as a genre flourishes in the West, but I still struggle with the kind of futures we seem most comfortable imagining. Thank you.
We now want to hand over to our fantastic panelists to highlight their voices and build harmonies and dissonances with our own. And we're extremely honored to introduce them. Our first speaker is Dorothy Santos, a Filipino-American writer, editor, curator, and educator. She has written and spoken on a wide variety of subjects, including art, activism, artificial intelligence, and biotechnology. She's managing editor of Hyphen Magazine and a Yerba Buena Center for the Arts Fellow, where she is researching the concept of citizenship. Her talk today is entitled Machines and Materiality, Speculations of Future Biology and the Human Body. Thank you.
First of all, I'm all about weird behavior and cultural mutation. Good afternoon again. My name is Dorothy Santos. And let me see if I get my slides on here. Perfect. And I first want to thank the festival organizers, Morehshin, Daniel, and fellow panelists, Rasheedah, Luiza, and Pedro, for this opportunity to be in conversation. So I'll start out about 2 years ago. I learned about Stephen Tomasulo's book, Voss, an opera of flatland. The pages are filled with, with prose of the protagonist's square and circle. as they navigate systems, infrastructures, and environments where the human body can be designed, grafted, and re-engineered. His book served and still serves as foresight into a life that is fast approaching, if not already here. Much like Thomas Sula, the artists I have researched for the past couple of years incorporate scientific methodologies to critique and subvert the infrastructures and systems of long withheld and accepted scientific practices. Their works, individually and collectively, aim to show different ways human bodies are subject to surveillance, the inevitable evolution or de-evolution of human memory, the oppression of trans bodies, specifically trans women, as well as what our microbial makeup might say about our health in the future. So let's start off with John Craig Freeman, who's best known for his work in augmented reality. In his work, EEGAR, Things We've Lost, Freeman explores the use of augmented reality connected to our awareness of memories and what we might be able to conjure up through our neural activity, something that we've lost, for instance, in this case. I initially read the work as a speculative piece, and soon realizing that AR technology, in concert with EEG, reading brainwave sensors, actually fathoms a world where our brain frequencies may be able to one day pull from a larger shared network of information and data, thus affecting the way we remember. The following work by Heather Dewey Hagborg, which is titled Stranger Visions, is what I'm going to talk about next. And in 2012, Dewey Hagborg created 3D portraits based on the DNA she collected from hair, cigarettes, gum, and fingernails. The detritus of the New York landscape served as raw material in her explorations of what she calls genetic surveillance. The sculptures eerily look at nobody. They're strangers. The gazes that we know nothing about, other than the appearances that were based on genetic material shed by the owner without them knowing what it could possibly produce or what it might become. Dewey Hagborg begs the question of the ramifications of DNA phenotyping in an incredibly biased world. The assemblages of machines in Revital Cohen and Ter Van Balen's The Immortal, the machines breathe life into each other and serve as a type of functional body. The viewer is taken into an ecosystem of mechanics that becomes a metaphor into the way we live as humans and our increasing dependence on machines. These machines are the cornerstones of medical advancements, made by humans to save or prolong life for reasons beyond the machine's capacity. As a matter of fact, the machines function exactly as they are intended, which makes Immortal all the more mesmerizing as a representation of machines as body. In another work by Cohen and Van Balen titled Sterile, this project equates the creation of the world of within the world of design and bioengineering, reifying the human as a creator of life outside the human species. What you're seeing here is an albino goldfish that was engineered to hatch without reproductive organs. The duo worked in collaboration with Professor Yamaha and his laboratory in Hokkaido, Japan, where Professor Yamaha created an addition of 45 goldfish as objects that were unable to partake in the biological reproductive cycle. And here, Laura Splaine's work, Manifest, helps us understand our bodies by distancing what's seemingly intangible and almost, it's interesting to see how emotions may not be tangible, but she makes them tangible and manifest. So to the left is smile and to the right is frown. And what she does here is she takes electromagnetic pulses and captures them and uses them to create 3D printed data visualizations. The work suggests how we can explore and discuss artworks that experiment with the natural sciences and in a way where the tools, the technologies, and the methodologies within science become the way art is made. So I'll read the screenshot first. This is a video work done by queer trans Latina artist Misha Cardenas. They told me I would be sterile, the doctors and brochures, that I couldn't do this, what I'm doing. But they don't know. They lied to me. Other trans women have done it. I mourn the loss of my children and family, I've heard my friends mourning them too. But the truth is that even after 8 years of estrogen and T blockers, you only have to go off your hormones for a few months to make gametes. Other trans women taught me how to do it. So again, this is a screenshot from Misha Cardenas' work, Pregnancy, done in 2015. And it's a poetry and bio-art project that was created during a two-month period when she stopped taking prescribed hormones. This work was a response to the lack of literature and resources for trans women of color regarding reproductive health and the actual erasure of trans women's bodies who desire the experience of childbirth. And the final artist that I'll talk about today is Annie Liu. Her work, Kisses from the Future, speculates our microbiota, or microbial data, essentially the microbes that inhabit our body space. And to be clear, not inside the body, but within our immediate spaces and the bacteria we share with others. And she used this work as a way to explore what it might look like in the future to gauge health or even the desirability of a partner based on your guts, essentially. So here, you'll see the bacteria forming on Lou's impression of her lips. And the whole work actually gives new meaning to from the gut and is connected deeply to the branch of science of psychoneuroimmunology, which is the study of how our nervous system and immune system fight disease. And so her work actually looks at what this might be in the future. If imagine looking at someone's microbial profile and basing judgments off of their nervous and immune systems. So each of these artists use their practices to explore the ways in which technology is changing our understanding of our surroundings, the biological information in our environments and what they contain, and the implications of technology. In his book, The Whale and the Reactor, Langdon Winner suggests that technologies are life forms in that they gain a second nature as they become deeply embedded in our daily lives. He argues the creation of various technology, including biological agents, computers, industrial machinery, and they all have political and social implications that produce new human patterns of behavior. He states, quote, "Vast transformations in the structure of our common world have been undertaken with little attention to those alterations, to what those alterations mean. Judgments about technology have been made on narrow grounds. Paying attention to such matters as whether a new device serves a particular need, performs more efficiently than its predecessor, makes a profit, or provides a convenient service. Only later does the broader significance of the choice become clear, typically as a series of surprising side effects or secondary consequences. But it seems characteristic of our culture's involvement with technology that we are seldom inclined to examine, discuss, or judge pending innovations with broad, keen awareness of what those changes mean. In the technical realm, we repeatedly enter into a series of social contracts, the terms of which are revealed only after the signing," end quote. So I wanted to conclude by saying that machines and digital technology not only change the way we work, but they modify the register at which we understand the world outside of our bodies and our immediate environments. Foreign places are made all the more foreign when we are called upon to see them through scientific methodologies that now have become a medium for artists to capture the changing tides of how art is understood and experienced and what it can be. We become dependent on someone else, knowing the knowledge that we should and ought to know for ourselves. And with the political and cultural state of the world, we have to work harder at recognizing the ways in which the human body may be subjected to unethical practices, outright discrimination, and draconian legislation that devalues, in particular, Black, brown, queer, trans, immigrant, and disabled bodies. We have much more agency than we think, but it does reside in a place of resistance. In particular, paying close attention to technological changes and advancements that directly affect the health and well-being of marginalized individuals. These artists are asking important questions and have put into great care into imagining, but an inevitably real, future, to make certain we use scientific technologies in a way that will serve us and enable us to evolve as opposed to hindering progress and slipping into extinction ourselves. Thank you.
Next, we have Luiza Prado and Pedro Oliveira. They're Brazilian design researchers who very recently wrapped up their PhDs at the University of the Arts in Berlin. Under the parede alias, the duo researches new design methodologies, processes, and pedagogies for an onto-epistemological decolonialization of the field. In their joint talk and performance, Luiza and Pedro will explore the tensions around hyperdense gravitational pulls and acts of resistance, with particular focus on the so-called non-lethal bombs manufactured in Brazil and exported and deployed all around the world.
If singularity, singular, became singularities, plural, would you feel their surfaces and touch the universes inside them? If singularity, singular, became singularities, plural, would you see through their dimensions and accept words that maybe don't roll out of your tongue the way they do for others? When they hurl a bomb, singular, at the crowd, plural, we bend like so many stalks of grass attacked by a gust of wind, trying to withstand, flexible and pliable, a force we don't understand. Fear and anger rise through our throats, make it into a thousand screams, disturbing a soundscape that says, unwanted, unwelcome, dissenting. Someone yells, there are children here, as if this admission would stop things from moving, the smoke from suffocating, all this from happening. The street is empty. Smoke lingers like a hangover, like stale breath and morning regret. This horror, they say, is not like other horrors. This bomb, they say, is safer and better. It does not do to you what other bombs do to other people that you were taught to hate in other places that you were taught to hate. What they really mean is you can become those people whenever they decide. Unlike other bombs, they say, this one does not fragment into a million pieces of shrapnel that tear through bodies and fabric and metal and concrete. They call it a stun grenade, a flashbang, a sound bomb. They call it non-lethal, as if death existed only at the intersection of flesh and metal. They say it disorients the enemy, singular, to help law enforcement, singular, maintain order and peace, both singular. They say the bomb, singular, does not cause permanent injury. We shudder. Although literature describes that a woman's heart stopped after a bomb exploded in her small apartment, she was dressed for work when police invaded, unannounced, but for the bomb and the sound and the light. There are other stories of a man who died protesting, of a couple who died in a fire, of people injured and disfigured. Yet, they assure us, the bomb is not lethal. It is better than the alternative. It does not want to kill. What they really mean is they can use the alternative whenever they decide to. It only wants to contain, to render immobile, silent, orderly. It only wants the greater good. It only wants us to behave, even when we don't want to. In Brazil, these bombs, still singular, are described as bombas de efeito moral, which means more or less moral effect bombs. When we were little, we always imagined that these bombs made people feel sad and cry, Although we weren't entirely wrong, today we ask ourselves why, from such a young age, these words are part of our vocabularies. Astrophysicists say that a singularity, singular, swallows everything around it. It munches and chomps and chews and crushes, and still it wants more. The singularity is a weird sort of colonialist. It wants everything for itself, and yet instead of sailing off to pillage and occupy and rape and murder, it pulls everything to its own mouth. Singularity sounds a lot like late capitalism. Singularity eats the food and licks the plate. Astrophysicists say that all the laws we think we understand cease to operate in singularity. They say they are not entirely sure about what happens to the things a black hole swallows. The singularity is a weird sort of bomb. It swallows and appropriates and destroys to then spit everything out again in its own forced order. Singularity, singular, just sounds like a way to politely scold an object that disagrees. It seems like a strategy to polish dissent, to dismiss unpredictability and insubordination as anomalies, impertinences. If you keep behaving like this, no other variable will agree with you. You will become an outcast object in an environment that just wants to abide to law and order. So just be quiet, just be well behaved, just do what we say. Technologies assume that singularity, singular, will be the moment, the glorious moment, when progress, that mysterious word that only seems to serve a few, will change humanity as we know it, as we experience it, as we see it. They offer no explanation of who is we. They say singularity, singular, will allow us, this mysterious collective entity, to shed the body like snakes shedding skin. Bodies, they assume, are invisible, unremarkable, unimportant. Bodies, they assume, are all made equal, homogeneous, uniform. All bodies, they assume, walk through the world without tripping. All bodies, they assume, are whole and wholesome and unbroken and solid. Yet, in the midst of the smoke, left by less bomb, singular, every particle in our bodies, plural, begs to disagree. Our bodies, foreign, shifting, mutant, are disarticulations, disorientations, turmoil. Our bodies expand and contract. They have been broken, then mended together with scotch tape and anger and maybe a joint for good measure. These bodies, plural, at times may trick us into thinking that they're whole when they're actually unfinished. Our bodies are the result of a multitude of other bodies, some dissenting, others voracious and all-encompassing and insatiable. Our bodies are betraying bodies, disruptive bodies. They are colonizer and colonized, amalgamated as flesh. Inscribed in our blood is violence, invasion, and death. We stand in a land that is simultaneously ours and not. We wonder if one day we too will explode in a scream. Amongst the smoke, the bomb, singular, follows us. A line of men, strangely singular, follows us. We listen to the sounds meant to drown ours, sharp, rhythmic, measured, and each step they take, they beat their truncheons on their shields. Mark rhythm in a threat of violence so real, so palpable and granular, coloring our fear. Their weapons tear our tender flesh, the living wall getting closer, a unity, homogeneous and flat, drowning our noises, those said to be unwelcome, subversive, crushing our chaotic rhythms with organized attacks. Ours is a rhythm war. We play trumpets and drums. We have songs and chants. Our rhythm is disjointed, uncoordinated, dissonant, and unarticulated. We leave crevices and cracks where other voices, other rhythms, may make their own homes. We are waves rolling back and forth, louder and quieter, expanding and contracting, words rolling out of our mouths. The bomb singular is hurled at us, plural, in timed steps, in rhythmic explosions. We scream plural, we hit back to plural, 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 in anger and endurance. It is in this moment that we realize we can explode too. We can rupture and fracture. We can resist the gravity and the density. We can take the bomb singular and kick it back, spit it out of our system like a rotten fruit. We don't need to lick the plate. We can share the food. We can remake singularity singular into singularities, plural, to make room, to make space for ours and those of others living under the same roof. If we are to become fragments, let these fragments be shrapnel.
Thank you so much. I'm still waiting for the explosion. And our last speaker today is Rasheedah Phillips. She is creative director of Afrofuturist Affair, a community formed to celebrate, strengthen, and promote Afrofuturistic and sci-fi concepts and culture. In her work with Black Quantum Futurism, Rasheedah derives facets, tenets, and qualities from quantum physics, futurist traditions, and Black African cultural traditions to celebrate the ability of African-descended people to see into and choose or create the impending future. In her talk today, Rasheedah will explore the history of linear time constructs, notions of the future, and alternative histories of temporospatial consciousness.
Where is the master clock? Who watches it and who keeps time? If the master clock stops, does time stop? Most people take their everyday experiences of time as a factual, unalterable facet of reality. There are clocks that chart the hours, minutes, and seconds, calendars that chart the march of days, months, and years, suns, planets, and stars that chart out the ages, mapping out cosmic time. More subtle, however, are the ways in which time governs our social interactions, regulates our emotions and our movements, frames our worldviews, informs our politics, and leaks into our very consciousness. The ways in which we are situated in time are reflected in how we talk about, think about, and conceptualize the world around us. In America, and in many other places, natural time has been overthrown by Western linear time, where temporal orientation is facilitated by clocks, schedules, cell phones, and calendars. The word future, by definition, designates a time period or temporal space that is not now, one that is situated ahead or before us, and one that is distinctive from times that lie behind or before the one we are currently situated in. Etymologically, future developed out of old French future during the late 14th century, meaning a time after the present, or that which is yet to be. Future can be traced back to the Latin futurus via the stem fu, to grow or to become, which is the future participle of the word esse, or to be. The Oxford English Dictionary notes that both esse and future share be at their root, which may explain why the word before can both denote an event that has already passed and is now in the past, or an event that has not yet happened. Notions of the future as that which lies ahead vary greatly. In traditional indigenous African spatio-temporal consciousness, for example, time was experienced as a matter of pacing, akin to walking, with time beginning when you arrive at your destination. African time also had a backwards linearity in that when events occur, they immediately move backwards towards what John Mbiti calls zamani or macro time. Future events are situated in a potential time until experienced or actualized. Those events do not depend on a specific clock time or calendar event for their manifestation. Instead, time depends on the quality of the event and the person experiencing it. Once the future event is experienced, it instantaneously moves backwards into the present and past dimension. Those two dimensions bear the most ontological significance, where a person experiences time partly in their own individual life and partly through the society which goes back many generations before his own birth. In contrast, a traditional European spatio-temporal consciousness around and prior to the 14th century saw time as flow and inevitability. Early recordings of an abstract sense of time as a continuous duration arose around the 14th century, while the word time itself derives from the word tide or tidis, which has its etymological roots in a Sanskrit word for division, to cut up, or to flood, as in the time of high water. Within the European Judeo-Christian order, work and prayer times were heavily regulated by laws. Because of a belief in the biblical apocalyptic visions of the end being near, the singularity, time had to be tightly regulated. In Time Wars, Jeremy Rifkin notes that the Western culture institutionalized its images of the future by way of religion and politics, making sure that the future was something that could be made predictable and controlled. It is through religion and politics that a linear temporal orientation first came to be discerned, simultaneous to the development of Western culture. The structure of time eventually came to be organized discreetly and causally into a past, present, and future, with fixed events set against a forward-moving timeline, one that would eventually come to a climactic, chaotic end. Prominent Western religious philosopher St. Augustine was among the first Western thinkers to view Christian-inspired, linear, irreversible time as an important feature of his philosophy. In his book, Confessions, he asks, how can a past and a future be when the past no longer is and the future is not yet? As for the present, if it were always present and never moved on to become the past, it would not be time, but eternity. This progressive future, one that is unidirectional and one that does not allow access to the past, was further forged through other significant events in science and technology. Dorn van Rossum notes, only since the scientific revolution in the middle of the 17th century can we speak of experimentally qualifying scientific procedures and conceptions of time as a scaled continuum of discrete events. The increased building and usage of public clocks and eventually personal watches and timepieces further inscribed a mechanical order of time impacting all aspects of the Western way of life. The second law of thermodynamics, developed around 1854, also reinforced the linear notion of time speeding into the future toward a chaotic end, while other significant temporal historical events, such as the building of the first long-distance railroads and the invention of the telegram, allowed the future to be conquered through a compression of space-time. For example, Stephen Kern writes of the relationship between the future and imperialism and colonialism, noting how the annexation of the space of others and the outward movement of people and goods are examples of spatial expressions of the active appropriation of the future. British Foreign Minister Lord Rosenberry noted, for example, in 1839, that the motivations for colonizing Africa is not about the present, not what we want now, but what we shall want in the future. Rosenberry considered the future as something to be mined, acknowledging the metaphor by stating that they were engaged in a business of pegging out claims for the future, considering he and his fellow imperialists trustees to the future of the race. Many of the radical movements, both during and after slavery, actively took on the language of the future in seeking to empower people to rise above their present circumstances. For radicals in a struggle for freedom from radical oppression, the future offered a potential source of hope. In 1892, abolitionist and former slave Frederick Douglass told a group of black students at Atlanta University, "Be not discouraged. There is a future for you and a future for me." On the other hand, in a speech delivered on July 4, 1854, attacking the hypocrisy of the American Independence Day celebration, he observed, "America is false to the past, false to the present, and solemnly binds herself to be false to the future, liable to repeat the same atrocities against humanity as it had against the enslaved." Marcus Garvey, founder of the Universal Negro Improvement Association, found history to be a hopeful precursor for the future, one that was subject to the creative force of the oppressed. He told his followers, "We have a beautiful future, and we shall create another in the future that will astonish the world." There is no past, or rather, where does the line between the past and the present draw? Was slavery over simply once declared? At what time did we become free? If time orders actions, when and where was the act of liberation? When did subjugation end? What time was it in a land my people were stolen from? How far away from slavery are we, when slavery as an institution was encoded into the dominant temporal order? In temporalities of pre-slavery, pre- and post-freedom superimposed, then collapsed into one another. At the turn of the century, an avant-garde Italian social movement known as Futurism attempted to revolutionize and reappropriate notions of the future in art, architecture, literature, and culture. Believing that the call of reverence to the past and to tradition should die, they created manifestos, artwork, music, and critical theory around a future rapidly speeding toward them. Much like Einstein's relativistic future, the future had now run into now, or as Filippo Marinetti wrote in Manifesto of Futurism in 1909, "Time and space died yesterday." In a manifesto of the futurist painters, written circa 1910, the futurists declared that the triumphant progress of science makes profound changes in humanity inevitable, changes which are hacking an abyss between those docile slaves of past tradition and us free moderns who are confident in the radiant splendor of our future. They embraced a violent, clashing, chaotic technological future, one that was constantly changing and perpetually at war with its own ideas. The future was not set, and because it was so transient, there could be no permanent buildings, no permanent monuments, or permanent empires. Envisioning themselves as the catalyst for Italy's rebirth, politics and culture were intermeshed for the Italian futurists, with the futurism movement containing some elements of anarchism and fascism. Notions of the future have virtually defined the genre of modern-day science fiction. These future visions began to take on a dystopian tone following the Victorian era of wonder, space, and high technology. H.G. Wells spent much of his career time traveling into dystopian futures through fiction, essays, and speeches. George Orwell's novel 1984 famously warns that who controls the past controls the future. Who controls the present controls the past. Real-life science and technology have benefited from the imaginations of science fiction writers as much as the reverse. Many sci-fi writers are in fact scientists or are consulted by scientists when their work predicts the future or thinks up new possibilities and uses for tech. The inevitable consequences of the rapidly changing future envisioned by the Italian futurists and the ones illustrated by science fiction is what Alvin Toffler called future shock, to describe the shattering stress and disorientation that we induce in individuals by subjecting them to too much change in too short a time. He believed that the greatly accelerated rate of social and technological change in our society produced mostly negative personal and psychological consequences, arising from the superimposition of a new culture on an old one, and producing a form of culture shock that the victim can never recover from. This was what Marinetti and the Italian futurists wished for, right? A future now that had permanently split from the past, brought about by a violent expansion of the scope of change. For Toffler, we were racing too far into the future, too quickly. The term future shock itself spread through popular culture, theory, and media after the release of Toffler's book. Curtis Mayfield had a song called Future Shock, on his album, which was in turn covered by Herbie Hancock as the title track for his 1983 recording, a jazz funk electronic fusion that was considered futuristic for its time. Future Shock, as described by Mayfield, is a world of poverty, drug addiction, hunger, desperation, oppression. When won't we understand? This is our last and only chance. Everybody, it's a future shock. His words hearken to a use of presentism time orientation. The darker side of the future is now. This represents how oppressed people today, particularly the descendants of enslaved Africans, embody temporal tensions, a disunity between cultural notions of time. Little analyzed are the ways in which contemporarily this temporal orientation is connected to class, poverty, oppression, racism, and the legacy of slavery. Maintaining a sense of presentism, being in the now, over a sense of futurism, has also been both a defense mechanism against Black communal trauma and post-trauma under the conditions of class warfare and racial oppression deriving from slavery, and a hearkening back to a more natural, ancestral, temporal, spatial consciousness. For example, Michelle M. Wright cautions, if we use the linear progress narrative to connect the African continent to Middle Passage Blacks today, we run into a logical problem, because our timeline moves through geography chronologically, with enslavement taking place at the beginning or in the past, and the march towards freedom moving through the ages toward the far right end of the line or arrow, which also represents the present. So essentially, we can never catch up. Additionally, Jeremy Rifkin explains the consequence of the linear progress narrative being applied to an oppressed person keeps them confined in a narrow temporal band, unable to anticipate and plan for their own future, powerless to affect their political fate. For those deprived of access to the future becomes untrustworthy and unpredictable. They become stuck, only being able to plan for the present and limited time in the future as the society around them speeds forward in illusory linear progress. This narrow temporal band is used to penalize people on a daily basis. Being 10 minutes late to court, for instance, can mean losing your job, your kids, your home, or your freedom. Hierarchies of time and lack of access to the future informs intergenerational poverty in the same way that wealth passes down between generations in traditionally privileged families. Womanist and feminist movements have also featured the future prominently. Michelle Wright also notes examples of Black womanist writers such as Octavia Butler and Alice Walker who create bold new models for a self-defined or internally defined notion of tradition. The time-traveling Black woman protagonist Dana in Octavia Butler's fantasy novel Kindred, for example, had to ensure the continuation of her family's timeline in the antebellum South, and by extension, her own birth 100 years into the future. So, how do we begin to control our own time and create new cultural, healthier time orientations? How can we encode new temporal algorithms? What does it mean to dismantle the master's clock? Physically, spiritually, psychologically, cognitively. How do we access and take back control of our own futures? There is a necessity to dismantle the master's clock and reinscribe a colored people's time, or perhaps more affirmatively, to construct a new diasporic African spatial temporal consciousness. There is a necessity to dissolve or dismantle the thermodynamic arrow of time and the arrow of progress. Mechanical time is not absolute time. The present moment is the ether, the absolute frame of reference. In some ways, being a radical means advocating for some vision of the future, one that is different than what our standpoint from the present offers. On the November 2015 cover of Wired, the words, "Let's change the future," are written in bold pink neon, previewing an issue dedicated to race, gender, and equality in a digital age, and guest edited by tennis star Serena Williams. The issue features articles on a Black Lives Matter movement as the 21st century civil rights movement, the lack of diversity in the tech industry, and one on a perceived battle over diversity that recently erupted in science fiction culture. In one article called War of the Worlds, Amy Wallace notes that sci-fi that accommodates one future, one kind of politics, and one kind of person just isn't doing its job. Understanding the utility of science fiction to envision new worlds and new futures in concrete terms, particularly for societies marginalized, Wallace's words call to mind those of Octavia Butler, who in an essay called Positive Obsession asked, what good is science fiction's thinking about the present, the future, and the past? What good is its tendency to warn, to consider alternative ways of thinking and doing? What good is its examination of the possible effects of science and technology or social organization and political direction? At its best, science fiction stimulates imagination and creativity. And what good is all of that to Black people? A new generation of science fiction writers and creators are using their work to answer those questions. Metro Polarity's Queer Speculative Fiction Collective, for example, and other grassroots collectives are choosing science fiction as our lens to create new worlds, identities, self-paradigms, and to destroy old harmful ones. Interrelated, the concept and community of Afrofuturism has emerged over the last 20 years and has developed as a tool, medium, and a lens that Black marginalized communities across the diaspora can use to evaluate or shape our futures. Art curator and Afrofuturist Ingrid LaFleur describes Afrofuturism as a way of imagining possible futures through a Black cultural lens, while professor and artist Dee Danang Akpem calls it an exploration and methodology of liberation, simultaneously both a location and a journey. Afrofuturism lends itself well to exploring notions of institutional liberation, unearthing our true histories, mapping our futures, understanding our present conditions in a flow of time through a speculative lens. Because it provides a perpetual bridge between the past, present, and future, Afrofuturism and the Black speculative imagination can be used as liberation technologies to build future worlds. Thank you.
On. Yeah. Thank you, everyone. So I think we have maybe time for one or two questions from our side, and then we will open it to the audience. So I want to ask a question. This is for all of us, so feel free to just jump in. About all these ideas of restarting, redefining from, you know, a different past to land into a new kind of future or a different kind of future, all these ideas around reimagining. I mean, you're Rasheedah talking about it in relationship to time, and then you are talking to it in relationship to space and bodies. And also, Dorothy, you're also talking about bodies in, you know, in like in relationship to both past and the future. So, and this also relates very much to my own research around these ideas of refiguring a history, like taking something and then reappropriating it, or recreating, I guess recreating is not the best word, but refiguring, maybe reimagining it in a way that it already doesn't exist. But I'm also interested in it in both practical and poetic conceptual ways. So we all like talked about these issues. We're all here, sitting here discussing it. And I want to ask about actions, like how do we take actions, like literal actions to participate in this? This is part of it. Part of it is presenting and maybe like raising awareness and talking about these issues. But also I want to talk about actions, like practical actions that can take part in this refiguring ideas and processes. So.
I can start. I don't know. It's there's a lot of ways. I think one of the ways, I think a very simple way, is to respect other people's temporalities and to realize that we are not all operating with the same time and with the same space constructs. We have our own internal clocks, and I think as a start, just knowing that, realizing that because it's 12 o'clock on that clock, it's not, that doesn't, you know, what does that mean to me or what does that mean to someone else? I think that's one way to start. I'm an attorney. I represent poor people in Philadelphia who are having housing issues, who are being displaced or being kicked out of their house. I think a practical way for me to think about these things and to think about world building is looking at the construct of time in courts and in the housing process, and when you're being displaced, how does time operate for those people, and really utilizing that in my advocacy. And I think that could be done in a lot of different ways in other areas, not just in the law. But I think the law is a very easy place because the time construct is very stark, although it's not acknowledged or, you know, we're not conscious of it. So that's for me, I think, and I think maybe within your own area of interest, exploring how time operates and exploring how you can subvert that or at least examine it and make it explicit about how time is operating, and only by making it explicit can you seek to change it or shift it or throw in an alternative construct. So
I'm the only one in here who hasn't talked yet, so yeah. I think, like, for Luiza and myself in our practice, since Rasheedah talked about time, so I think we could chime in and talk a little bit about space. What we have done in the past few years in our practice is exactly to use the privileged space that we both have in academia and being from South America here in Europe and kind of reoccupying that space by promoting different ways of understanding how that space is formed, so how forms of worlding happen within the academia, especially in design and in the arts. So most of our work has been centered around this profound interrogation of what makes design as a field and what are the principles, the modern principles, the colonial principles that inform this field and that are exported all over the world, including back home to us. And we have used our practice as a way of interrogating that and opening up spaces for other types of materialities to emerge, other types of contingent relations with material practices to emerge in the kind of work that we do, which is mostly sort of open works and pedagogical practices within design, but not only constrained to designers. So in terms of action, I think, like, for us was a time of also lots of self-questioning as well. And this is the way that we found the most productive for the kind of work that we were doing within academia to kind of breach those privileged spaces and kind of use ourselves and our privileged positions in academia to kind of breach in as a guerrilla tactic, so to speak. Yeah.
Is this on? Oh, it's on, okay. I think Rasheedah brought up something that totally resonated with me, which was the lack of access to the future, and it made me think of the lack of access to the present in relationship to how bodies are taken care of via the healthcare system. And I think and total secret, which isn't gonna be a secret anymore, my day job's actually in biotech. So time is very much of the essence when you're looking at a very sick body. And so I think one of the things that is very much privileged, and just to kind of bring up an example, which I didn't have time in my presentation, but there's an actual anti-aging study that's happening in California and Monterey, and subjects actually have to pay $8,000 for lab fees, and essentially, and I actually have a bottle, they're injected, so mature adults, which are considered 35 and older, I'm past that, so yeah, I guess I qualify for the study. They're basically injected with 1.5 liters of young blood, so that's about that much. And young blood is considered 16 to 24 years old. And so what the study entails, and I guess this is in relationship to the question, because I wanna say what kind of actions people can take, is, you know, this is an FDA-approved study. Okay, and that's like 2 years of monitoring these healthy, they're already healthy subjects, and seeing what changes happen in their overall health, improvement of their health, but also how they age. And I think that's a big thing in the US is aging, and this is in relationship to time. So that's a lot of people's understanding is how can I stop time for my own health, for my own well-being? And so for me, the direct action when I listen to studies like this actually happening, being approved by the FDA, is finding more, you know, instances such as this, where it's really rich cis white men saying, oh, well, I have extra money, I'm gonna make a study and do this, when there are so many people that are suffering and lacking the actual healthcare that they really need. And so an action would be very similar to what the Black Panthers did, is mobile clinics, coming up with solutions for people of how to take care of themselves and others. And that's not something you can waste time on.
Yeah, and I also want to add something in relationship to kind of, you know, science fiction and future. I think to think about future, to be able to
imagine even the future. You need to have hope. And that's also something I have thought about a lot, because I again think one of the reasons that, let's say, in Iran science fiction never existed, like no one cared about it or took it seriously, was because no one like had time to think about future. The future was in the hands of so many unforeseen things that it just never came up as this thing that you could focus on. And so I think in relationship to self-care, in relationship to participating in all these conversations, and then understanding where you are also, like as activists, as participants of these conversations, and being able to have certain kind of hope in a way that you reimagine this future. I think that is also something that I've been thinking a lot about. So I'm gonna start writing science fiction stories, Iranian science fiction stories.
You should, yeah.
Yes.
As a cis white man, not a rich one, maybe. No. I would like to add something. I'm interested in the way that we're talking all about futures here, and I think it relates to what Dorothy's just talked about in terms of people trying to keep a stasis. So we use these technologies to keep something that we hold, whether it's in the present, and hopefully that's what we project forward. And I think that even we tend to do that from our positions. We talk about the future as if we are the ones that will be passing into it. And one thing that I think is really vibrant about this festival this week is the way in which we've talked about all of these new technologies, these new emergent things that are going to produce not just new futures, but new subjects, new kinds of subjects, new diverse arrays of peoples and combinations of machines, and we are embracing, as we have done for decades, different kinds of bodies, sexualities, gender associations, and we're trying to include those in our definitions. So I want to kind of just open that up as a prospect that we try and to create futures, maybe these speculative weird ones, the weirder the better, because the weirder that they are, the more likely that they are to be able to include these kinds of subjectivities that we haven't yet been able to come into contact with, that aren't our subjectivities. And just to finish up, I think that one thing that ties all of our panels together and our work is the use of art and aesthetics as a way to produce this. I think Dorothy talking about artists' work, your guys' performance, and I know as well Rasheedah's work and mine and Morehshin's work, the way to like make new futures bubble into being can only take place through imagination and creativity. So yeah, that's me finished, but I just wondered what you guys thought before we open up to the audience.
Now for a comment on Pedro and Luisa's performance. I think one of the things that stuck out to me was I wrote down disarticulation, disorientation. It reminded me of this idea or this scientific method of parabiosis, where you take two organisms and then you connect them together so that they can live off of each other. How, you know, they've done this with mice, where it's literally like almost sewing the bodies together. But in essence, you know, when a lot of the research that I've conducted around, you know, what people are doing, such as, you know, with the anti-aging study, you know, it's always for how can I become almost like superhuman, and that's not the point. It's like, why can't something such as parabiosis be for the help of other, meaning to heal the other? And, you know, like, why can't we start thinking about futures like that? And I think that's one of the things that I realized, even listening to everyone's talks today and this idea of singularity and, like, weird behavior. We have to get to a point where the weird behavior actually becomes the norm. And I think we have a long way ahead of us for that. And I think it's, I guess, the last thing I wanted to point out was, you know, all of the works that we've talked about, and then the artistic practices of Rasheedah, Luiza, and Pedro, and, you know, Morehshin and Daniel, it's all about also this idea that Gail Solomon talks about, body auxiliaries, and how they manifest physically outside of our bodies because of this idea of felt sense, like what do we feel in our bodies? And I think one of the things that comes to mind is when you are queer, I identify as a queer Filipina American, that's gonna be a very different sensation for me and how that's gonna manifest. But I think it's also realizing, you know, other bodies, like, you know, if you're queer and you're trans and Latina and you want to experience childbirth, what does that mean when that is not an option for you? You have to think about that for yourself. And so in Misha's work, I've always been a longtime fan of her work and her research, is she's actually making that future for herself. And I think that's what we have to keep kind of continue doing, disorienting and disarticulating.
I mean, I just had like a really brief comment. It's more like of a, it's not an idea of my own, but just to kind of pop in what you said, like this idea of becoming superhuman. During our research, we came across this really interesting book called Habeas Viscus by Alexander Wehelie. And in that, he talks about the notion of the human as like, as something that was denied to many bodies and to many types of what he calls racialized assemblages. But instead of saying, like, I think like the kind of work that at least we see ourselves trying to do is not an attempt to become, to reclaim the word human, but rather to pay attention to what is not, what was denied of humanity to certain bodies, and to listen to what these known or less human bodies have to say, what Wehelie calls in his books the groans of the flesh. And when I read that, it resonated a lot to me, because it's not about trying to reclaim certain spaces that were denied, but rather creating new spaces in which our own identities can be themselves, rather than, you know, accommodating to Eurocentric narratives of what humans should mean, you know? So, I mean, as I said, I'm paraphrasing an entire book here, but it's just as a recommendation of something that really resonated, and I think it resonates with what, for instance, Misha Cardenas is doing, or all of the sorts of works in Afrofuturism as well.
Okay, so let's open it to everyone sitting here. Are there any questions?
You have to come up to these beautifully lit microphones.
Hi, thank you very much for the panel. I think it was really one of the most inspiring panels that we've seen so far. This is sort of a difficult question to phrase, but so in the, you know, the time that we're in now, where borders, I guess, and nations and these sorts of concepts are becoming so much more relevant, I wanted to ask a question. So we've heard a lot about bodies, which I think is really important, but I wanted to ask a question about land. I do a lot of collaborative work with an Aboriginal art centre in Australia, and through that have been kind of rethinking, I guess, the way that narratives about land and ownership of land and, you know, this kind of, yeah, I guess just that sort of myth around land has been really co-opted by fascist and nationalistic movements and ideas. I'm not really sure how to phrase the actual question part of this, but I just wondered if anybody on the panel had something to kind of say about not just bodies, but how we can maybe apply some of these ideas to concepts about land and country and how to kind of earth ourselves in that literal way in these imagined futures.
I haven't myself started necessarily exploring that, but there are people who are exploring that, time and temporality and how that operates in land ownership, and how time passes down through title, and how title to land allows people to strip indigenous people of their land and their own temporality and way of owning the land. So I can't think of any names off the top of my head, but I know a few people who have written about that. I could certainly pass that on to you. So there are people thinking about that, and it's really interesting work and things.
Can I say something? Yeah. So actually, a lot of the work that I've been doing in the last, you know, since I moved from Iran to the US has been in relationship to land. And what is it? I can't also go back to Iran. I mean, I shouldn't, because I've done a lot of politically related work that I could get into trouble for. So, and then everything that happened this week is like, what does it mean to be stuck between now two fascist countries and lands, and then where do you go from there? But I have found virtual space a really interesting place to to explore a possibilities of these lands you built for yourself. I worked on a piece called The Romantic Self-Exiles, which is an animation piece, and I used 3D environments, software called Maya, and kind of like reimagining a new land, like taking elements from things I remember the most or cared the most from Iran, my house, etc., and then rebuilding it in this virtual space. And I also, like, the only relationship now I have with Iran after not 6 years of not going back is virtual. That is the only relationship I have to it, like reading things online, talking to my friends and family on Skype. So I'm really interested in that, like how you can use this virtual space then as maybe a way of reproposing a land, a space that then can belong to you, can belong to a collective, and yeah, then it, there is potential for that, so.
Oh, no, go ahead. Well, about land, much of our work is influenced by the Zapatista movement, which takes a super interesting approach to the question of land. One thing that they say that we were trying to explore too in our performance here was the question of creating a space where several universes can coexist, can be there and not in equal footing. So yeah, this is something maybe that would help you, I guess, looking into Zapatista ideas of land and cohabitation.
I think that's a great question, by the way. One of the first things that came to mind was the Dakota Access Pipeline and even the language around how the protectors are protecting the land. And I think it's an interesting question because I believe that the body is inextricably linked to the land. This is something one of the examples I was going to bring up, again, there wasn't much time, and I'll make this fast, but in Kuwait in July 2015, there was a DNA sample law that was enacted. So in order to enter the country or leave the country, you have to actually give, you're mandated to give a DNA sample. And what does that mean? What does mandated biosurveillance mean when the country tells you, we just want to make sure that you're a citizen? We want to make sure that you're in our database just in case you do something. And that goes for any country. Like, what does it mean for that governing body to actually say, you don't have sovereignty over your body anymore because of what you might do to the land? So I think those are a couple of the things that came to mind when you were talking about, or you asked the question.
So. Yeah, so one last thing. And I just recently saw a project, which is this science fiction kind of documentary, but it's, and I forgot the name of the artist, but he is reimagining all these refugee, from I guess mostly Syria, going to Mars. And I just talk how like Elon Musk going to Mars is like such a kind of weird position, you know, when there's like people, immigrants and refugees and etc., right? So I do think that's also an interesting way to, again, reimagining the possibilities, like not sending Elon Musk to the Mars, but like maybe other people. I'm gonna get so many bad comments from all the lovers of Elon Musk. But yeah, that's how I've been thinking about it. What does it mean to then make space for something that no one imagines or talk about, you know? And I think that is also an important position.
We have a question here.
This is a really great panel. Thank you so much for Transmediale inviting all of you to come and speak with us. But on one hand, I have to say something about the Transmediale structure that I think needs to be looked at, is that it's really sad that this conversation is happening on Sunday morning. So there's a glaring temporal problem with how Transmediale has scheduled this. And with that in mind also, I've been coming to Transmediale for many years, and you know, these sorts of conversations do get marginalized here and in many other institutional type situations. And how can we, I want to ask the question maybe for ideas, how can we interject our concerns and our debates into the more mainstream conversations, like, you know, being able to debate Elon Musk on having so much power over our future, and how do we fight for that time and space to interject these fights and concerns in with the people who are dominating the technological environments that are being imposed on us.
Thank you. That's a huge question to answer, and we can't speak for Transmediale. I think Morehshin had part of an answer, that this talk is being streamed and recorded, and all of you, when it finally makes itself online, you should share the shit out of it. That would be one good way to do this. And another is, without blowing our trumpet too much, but we have the privilege to be the residents for Transmediale, and to do our work here in the summer and create work with others. And it's our privilege to share that space and to introduce and include others in the space that's been made for us. And I think that that's hugely important for anybody who is invited onto panels and invited into institutions to consider what they have, their privilege, and to use it and to abuse it and to really push and make spaces where they didn't exist before. So that would be my answer, you guys.
I'm going to be the angry South American, and I'm going to say become shrapnel. These spaces, we had experiences with very exclusive spaces and how they treat dissident voices in the past year, including especially in academia. And there is no way they're going to make space for you unless you become shrapnel, unless you make the space yourself and kick down the door and go for it.
Bad behaviors. But it's about that. Yeah.
Yeah, I was going to sort of say the same thing. Like, this is an ongoing struggle. This is not new. Just because this like information feels new. I think we have to force ourselves into spaces. We have to continue to do that. We have to continue to use art and other mediums to transmit these messages. It can't just be a talk. It can't just be a debate. It has to be done in different ways and through different mediums, through music, through all of these things. And that's what I use my work for. But yeah, I've always had to force myself into spaces. I don't imagine that's going to stop. That's what you got to do.
So ditto to what everyone else said. Thank you for your comment, by the way. The irony of it is this is the first panel that I've been on where I, with people of color, to be honest, and it's in another country. So the strangeness of that for me even to realize I have to go to different places to see what I don't see often. And I think what everyone else has said is, you've already done this, is showing up and finding the resources. And, you know, I mean, Heather is here. Heather Dewey-Hagborg's actually, hi, sorry, Heather. And, you know, just to be able to find the people that, you know, can advocate for your work. And I think that's, you know, that's very difficult and that's very challenging. And when you are the voice of dissent or the voices of dissent telling people, look what's happening out in the world. Do you see what kind of studies people are doing and what, you know, it's hard. It's hard to find that audience. But again, it's becoming shrapnel. I really love that idea and that phrase. I think that's what we're all doing and what we continue to do. But I'd like to also throw in that being a hammer wrapped in velvet is the best way I'd like to be.
And I wanted, like, but this is, again, like going back to this conversation around like a constant struggle, right? But also the fact that you're always the one who has to speak up. And I find that actually troubling because I actually want the people who are not people of color, white people, et cetera, to feel the responsibility to speak up. Because then you always become the one person who has the big mouth. And I don't have a problem with that. I've been like that since I was, you know, 8 years old. But it's nice for people to be able to take this responsibility, to not always put this burden on us, because it's a constant struggle. And then seeing other people being able to get up and ask a question like that, I think there's a lot of value to that. So thanks.
I think, is it Sarah Ahmed calls that the feminist killjoy, that the feminist is the one that is made to speak out, but she embraces that. We should all be killjoys, and we should enjoy being killjoys, and enjoy shitting on people's parades as often as possible.
Yeah.
Any more questions? I have this image in my head that I can't get out, and I don't want to, like, be the last speaker, so I hope that you guys respond to this. But Rasheedah talked about the time machine, H.G. Wells, and there's a point in the time machine that the protagonist is trying to figure out what the hell's going on, and he goes to the museum in his very kind of academic, scientific way to look at the artifacts to try and figure out what's happened to this civilization. And it's at that point that he realizes that he is looking at his own past and not trying to figure out something from a point that's yet to take place. And this collapse, this moment of absolute collapse, realizing that he's past the point at which any kind of intellectual action could take place, it's only at that point that he goes and he rips a piece of metal off an old sculpture, and he goes and kills the warlocks with the metal. It's only at that point of collapse that action really becomes the only way for him to act in the world. And I think that's one thing that we wanted this panel to be, as something to take all of the work and the words of this conference, and when we leave this room, that's hopefully after the singularity we can grab that metal and kill some warlocks. I don't want to be the last image. Whoever the warlock is, that's up to you.
I just wanted to say thank you for being here, and Transmediale should give us the 8 o'clock Saturday night stage next year.
Thank you so much, and to our amazing panelists, please give them another round of applause.